I'm going to start off with the big news of the day. LSU pulls off the upset against Florida 49-42, but they still decide to part ways with head coach Ed Orgeron after the season. Now, there were reports coming out saying that this wasn't really something that just took place. Like, this is something that was already in the works of Ed Orgeron and LSU coming to a mutual agreement to part ways dating back to last week. There were people saying that players didn't want to play for him and coaches didn't want to coach for him. Now, ever since LSU won the national championship in 2019, led by Joe Burrow, and it seemed to be the perfect storm, everything has kind of went downhill for that LSU program led by head coach Ed Orgeron. Now, a lot of people try to discredit Ed Orgeron for that national championship. I feel like nobody really gives him enough credit because everybody just says, well, he had Joe Brady, he had Dave Aranda, he had Joe Burrow. But I mean, you have to give the man props for assembling that good of a coaching staff and having a team like that come together and be as good as what they were. Like, I just feel like you just can't simply discredit somebody just because the guys he had around him. I mean, he did hire him. Now, he hasn't really done a good job of picking his coaching staff ever since then. He lost a lot of talented players to the league. And there are a lot of non-LSU fans who are disagreeing with the decision to part ways. And I understand where those non-LSU fans are coming from. They're saying that Ed Orgeron needed more time. They didn't really allow him enough time to rebuild. But LSU fans are saying when you're playing in the SEC and you're coaching at LSU, a program that consistently brings in top 5, top 10 recruiting class, you don't rebuild, you reload. Now, nobody's expecting you to compete and win a national championship year after year after year, but people do expect you to be a really good football team. At least 9 to 10 wins minimum is the expectation for that LSU program. And Ed Orgeron, ever since winning the national championship, you know, this LSU program didn't really ascend. Anytime a team wins a championship, you know, they should always ascend or be somewhat around that level. You know, LSU was still supposed to be around 9-10 wins. Now, last year, you know, it was a COVID year, so everybody made the excuse for him saying, you know, give him another year, see what happens a year after. And then, you know, this season kind of hasn't really went as planned. Everybody was expecting LSU to bounce back and be a legitimate contender in the SEC West. They lost to UCLA to open the season. Then, you know, they had a couple of, you know, disappointing losses there. But, I mean, you got a big win against Florida. But a lot of non-LSU fans, you know, they're a little bit surprised. But LSU fans, I definitely understand why the decision was made. And even then, I feel like there's a good amount of LSU fans. I feel at least like 30% of LSU fans out there don't really agree with the decision to part ways of Ed Orgeron. And I'm kind of on the opposite side of the spectrum. I kind of understand why LSU decided to part ways of Ed Orgeron. I agree with the decision to part ways of Ed Orgeron because, I mean, after that 2019 year, everything has kind of went downhill. He's had some off-the-field issues. But one thing that I don't agree with is the narrative that, you know, he lost the locker room, players didn't want to play for him, coaches didn't want to coach. Like, yesterday, to me, it looked like those players wanted to play for him. I feel like if you completely lose the locker room, it will be indicated by the final score. And I haven't really seen any games played this year where LSU just completely got outmatched and outclassed. Now, maybe that would have happened when they played Alabama this year. But I mean, I haven't really seen any games where LSU was just completely blown out outside of that Kentucky loss when Kentucky beat them 42-21. But I mean, I look look back at that Florida game yesterday, and I didn't really see a team that gave up on them. You know, maybe a couple of star players like Derek Stingley, you know, Keyshawn Boutte didn't like him, anything like that. But, I mean, this team played very well under him, and they were able to pull off the upset. Like, I really felt like if he completely lost the locker room, this team wouldn't have had defeated Florida, which Florida is a pretty solid football team. You know, not the great Florida team that we saw last year, but, you know, this is still a pretty decent football team. This is the same Florida team that took Alabama to the wire early on this past this season. So, I mean, what's next for LSU? Who do you hire? Okay, are you going to try to pay big money to lure Luke Fickell out of Cincinnati? I think that Luke Fickell has a better chance leaving Cincinnati for the LSU job than I think he does leaving for the USC job. Now, ultimately, I still feel like he's going to stay at Cincinnati. First of all, I feel like Cincinnati going to the Big 12 conference now is going to help out recruiting. On top of that, Cincinnati is a team that right now is on the brink of making college football history, maybe being the first G5 program to ever make it into the college football playoffs. And right now, this team is in a national championship conversation. Luke Fickell has built something really good in Cincinnati. And on top of that, I think his son currently plays on the team. So, I mean, I understand why he could make the move, you know, more money probably. On top of that, you have a better chance to remain contending for national championships at LSU compared to Cincinnati, where you may have some down years per se, because maybe you may be capped in terms of how good you could be when it comes to recruiting. But overall, I still feel like there's a good chance that Luke Fickell could stay in Cincinnati, but it's pretty hard to turn down that LSU job, because there are a lot of people saying that the LSU job is more appealing than USC. Then on top of that, you know, you have a couple of other names thrown out there. I think Billy Napier probably could be a potential realistic candidate high on LSU's list, because you got to remember, the Louisiana Raging Cajuns play in the state of Louisiana, so I'm pretty sure whoever's doing this coaching search for LSU has probably done a lot of due diligence on Billy Napier, because he's literally probably right down the freaking street, and he's done a fantastic job with that Raging Cajuns football program. So I definitely feel like he's probably going to be amongst the top of their candidates when it comes to doing this coaching search. But who's going to be next, really? Because, I mean, like, I really feel like LSU is going to bring in a big name. It's not going to be some guy that we never heard of before. Now, what's next for Ed Orgeron after this year? You know, if he finishes off the season on a high note, you know, they win 7-8 games, then he's most likely probably going to be employed at another school. Now, I don't know if he'll be employed at another P5 program. You know, he may be like a group of five coach. You know, he may end up going to a G5 program and being a head coach there, but I don't really know if we'll see him get another P5 job. A lot of people keep saying, you know, him to USC. I don't really know if USC will bring him in. Some people are saying Miami. I don't really know if Miami will be able to put out the money, able to, you know, bid for Ed Orgeron, because I do feel like if there's a market for Ed Orgeron, I don't really feel like Miami is that committed to the football program that they would want to bring him in. Miami normally likes to go the cheap route when it comes to bringing in these coaches. They normally bring coaches in from like a P5 level or something like that, and, you know, bring them up to a larger scale school. But I mean, for Ed Orgeron, I definitely feel like he's going to be a head coach somewhere next year. Rather, that's at a lower Power 5 program or at the G5 school, because, like, I do feel like there are some characteristics about Ed Orgeron that a lot of people kind of overlook. You know, I feel like he definitely is a guy who can get you motivated to play for a game. He's definitely somebody who can fire up. I definitely feel like he can get the most out of his players at time, as we saw last year when they pulled off the upset against Florida. There were a lot of young players playing in that game that, you know, he got a lot out of. within that game. He also gets the most out of the younger players on the roster, in my opinion, you know. So I really feel like he does have some really good traits. Now, he's not really that great when it comes to assembling a great coaching staff, which is something that, you know, is a big indictment against him, because he's not really an X's and O's coach. He's not really, you know, an offensive guru or a defensive guru. He's more of a program builder, per se, or like a motivator. You know, he's a pretty good recruiter, but something that he kind of hasn't really done all that well outside of 2019 is bringing in the right people for his coaching staff. 2019, when he brought in Joe Brady, was kind of like the perfect storm for him. So I'm really interested in seeing what happens with Ed Orgeron. I definitely feel like we could see him being a head coach somewhere next year. But for LSU, man, the coaching search is going to be really interesting. And I only have like two names on top of my head right now, but I'll probably come around sometime later today or sometime this week and give you guys a more in-depth list of potential candidates who I feel could potentially succeed Ed Orgeron next year after this year when they part ways in 2022.